the regulations are, and you know, at first glance, they're very simple. There is one act, central, which is called the Motor Vehicles Act of 1988. And as far as public transport is concerned, it has two or three or four types of individuals or players or entities that it it covers, right? So there are what you would call taxi guys who are contract carriage, get a contract carriage permit. Now what a contract carriage permit is that anybody who has a motor vehicle which is a four-wheeler and who takes his passenger from point A to point B without stopping in any place, right? This is important for context for our case studies later. So these are taxi guys. The next kind of guys are stage carriers. And the word stage carriers is a contrast from the contract carriage guys, because stage carriers help you break your journey into stages. So if there is a bus which is going from Connaught Place to Gurgaon, it has a lot of stages in between. You can get off in between in Dhola Kuan or, you know, in some other place. So as a passenger, you can either be somebody who's a part of a stage of the journey or for the entire journey, and this is what stage carrier permits help you do. Now mind you, there's a basic difference between a contract carriage guy and a stage carriage guy. So a contract carriage has now become to be people who are getting these permits on a per vehicle basis. So you have a Maruti Suzuki Desire and you want to use it commercially, you get a contract carriage permit for it. Whereas for stage carrier guys, there's a distinction that is involved, and that distinction basically is what? Is that you don't get it for a particular bus or a, you know, maxi cab or an omni bus, or, you know, these are all the terms we use in the act, by the way. It's for the activity of doing stage carriage, and you can have people who form, you can have various vehicles under it. So when you're applying for a permit, you have to show how many vehicles do you have, what routes do you want to ply on, and basically the regulatory intent seems to be that the problem there is that, you know, you are dealing with people's luggage, you are dealing with long-term transport, and therefore you need to be a reliable kind of a person, as against a contract carriage guy who's basically doing a point A to point B, where the interaction and the number of people you're interacting with is kind of low. So that's about your stage carriages. The third, which I have not mentioned here, I just briefly touch upon, are goods carriers. Basically people who are, you know, are entitled to carry goods. And again, this is something which is basically, which does not envisage bikes as of now, and, you know, all your logistic service providers like your road runners and whatnot. This does not envisage that. This basically, the picture that the regulations form in your mind is one of a lorry and people who are, you know, doing that kind of, you know, trucks basically. And lastly, section 93 of the Act talks about what we call agents and canvassers. Now this is the messiah, so to say, of all aggregators, because there is nothing really else in the Act under which they fall, right? Because the hallmark of a sharing economy is what? Is that you don't own the cars, you don't employ the drivers, but you still play an important part in the urban mobility sector. So how do you regulate these guys? And in the Act, fortunately, they have found a place to do that, which is if you're an agent or a person, you know, who solicits people to buy tickets to sit on a bus or on a taxi, and you know, this generally again invokes the image of those touts you would get on the railway station and on the airport, who used to become, you know, who became a menace, so to say, and therefore they must have thought that, you know, it's a valid job that someone has, right? They're adding value, so let's regulate it. And now, as it has become, we have most cab aggregators and transport aggregators now falling under. You know, the word aggregator specifically is not mentioned currently. This was the central level. And there's a whole state level below us, which is, I'm talking about two, three different cities, and, you know, I don't want to bore you with the details of what's actually in all of them. I just talk about what the major thing, right? So Delhi came up with a fairly straightforward sort of regulations, which has your usual, the most interesting part there is that they also want to regulate fares, and, you know, they have an agenda against surge pricing, which is both good and bad. The other interesting part is that they would want you to have a minimum fleet of 200 taxis before you start off. Now, why this is interesting is because Karnataka, which I'm also going to get to later, has a similar condition in place, which was recently challenged, the constitutionality of which was recently challenged and upheld in Karnataka, saying that, you know, you can't have these kind of provisions. And it's interesting what's going to happen in Delhi, because unless you guys can tell me this, to my knowledge, there is no constitutional challenge pending on this regulation as of today. And it's curious why, because Karnataka has been successful. Maharashtra, the most interesting part is that they say that you have to have at least half your capacity to be more than 1400 cc of engine capacity. Frankly, I didn't quite understand where they're coming from. They didn't want smaller cars to be doing this, because you don't see SUVs anywhere. But what 1400 cc will mean is that you have these compact sedans and these this sedan class of cars coming in, and who they want to deal with is also something which is up for debate. Now, the other interesting regulation and why West Bengal takes a mention here is because of all the regulations that I've gone through, West Bengal is the most granular out of the rest. Like, you know, where they talk about how much, you know, that the picture should be clear and it should have a rating system and, you know, all these sorts of details. But what's even more interesting, you know, fine, even if you have all of that, because all of this is already there, and so it's only an issue for people who are coming into the market. But what's really interesting for West Bengal is that they have this concept of saying that you're an on-demand transport technology aggregator, and as long as you are not branding your service as a taxi service, you can get this license. But as soon as you start branding your service as a taxi service, you have to take a taxi license, basically a contract carriage license, which again makes it very curious is that tomorrow if somebody, you know, suffixes the word cabs with their brand name, then are they holding themselves out to be a taxi service provider and therefore running afoul of this? And again, these are issues which seem to be very, not very well thought out of, despite the fact that they have really detailed regulations in place. But why would you want that somebody not holds themselves out, or would you want that they call themselves a network of taxis or what? But it's not really clear that way.